So for the last session here today, I will go what we call a deep dive of OpenIO. So most of the presentation will be on the whiteboard, and I will explain everything about OpenIO, how it works, and how it works behind the scene. This is an interactive session, so if you have any question during the presentation, feel free to ask. There is a QA session at the end, but if you have any question during the presentation, feel free to raise your hand, because I will do a lot of technical stuff on the whiteboard. So here is the agenda. First of all, how OpenIO works. So a deep dive here, and I will explain everything. I will talk briefly about the OOFS, how it integrates. First party will be only object storage with S3 interface. Second party with the OOFS. And quick introduction about serverless computing. And at the end, if you have any question, I will let you ask your question. So how does it work? Okay, let's go. At OpenIO, we have what we call our S3 and Swift gateway. And let's say that, first of all, we will take the example of someone that wants to get an object, let's say the object 1, in the bucket, S3 bucket, let's say bucket 1. So we will have an S3 request here. So what will happen? We have, our Keystone stack to do the authentication. So basically, you will put your credentials. Then you will get a token from Keystone, and then when you go back to the Swift gateway, you give your token, and then you have access to the platform. I will not go too deep in that part, but it's a traditional authentication system. Now, what will happen with the OpenIO system? So we have what we call here our OOO proxy. I will explain you later what the OOO proxy will do. And if you know a bit of OpenIO, you will always heard about the meta zero level of indirection, then the meta one, the meta two. So this is our three level of indirection. And finally, the row X to store the blob and the chunks of data. So this is briefly the stack of OpenIO. So let's take this example of when you get the object one in the bucket one. Let's say that this object is already stored inside OpenIO. First of all, the bucket will have a hash name. Let's say that it will be A0, B3, and so on. So first of all, what will happen here is that the Swift will ask to your proxy, I want to access to this bucket. So you'll have a first request here at the meta zero level saying, okay, I want to access to the bucket with the name starting by A0B. So we'll have a request here. Okay, I want my bucket, the name is starting by this key. And here you will have a table with, okay, if you want to access to the bucket starting with A0B, you have, let's say that we are in a three-time replication mode for our directory. Meta 0, meta 1, and meta 2 is a directory. So we'll have three IP ports of meta 1 services, the next level of indirection. Again, I said three-time replication. It's a configuration if you want to put 5 times, 7 times. If you don't want to put replication, I'm not advising it at all, but you can do, it's open source, so at the end you can do whatever you want. But let's say that we are a three-time replication mode, so we will have three IP ports for meta one. And then the request is going back to your proxy, and the your proxy will take one of the meta one listed here and say, okay, and now you will put A0B3C5 and so on. You say, okay, now you will have, it's a hash code of bucket one. The request will be with the full name. Okay, I want to access to the bucket with the name A0B3C5 and so on. Same thing here. You will have a list of IP ports, again, let's say three-time replication mode, of Meta 2 services. Now, I think you got the process. The YoProxy will ask of will ask to one of the Meta 2, here it's this one, that he wants now the object one in this base. So here you will have a table for this specific bucket, bucket one, with for every object, so object one, a list again of IP port of ROIC services. Level of indirection. Again, let's say that for the data, we are in a three-time replication mode. If it's erasure coding, we'll have more entries here for the works. But again, to keep it simple, we will say that it's the three-time replication mode. So the list of ROIC services where you can find and get your data, you will have the information. And then our Python API, which are here in the Swift S3 gateway, will go directly to the ROICs, let's say this one, which is, I don't know, the first one. And the ROIC system is just an Apache with the WebDAV module, and will get the data, and the data is retrieved by the S3 gateway, and then you get it. Okay? So in three-time replication mode, you can get the full content in one request. Let's say that you are a 6 plus 3 Azure coding scheme, you will get 6 chunk of the data. The S3 gateway will compute and give you back your object. Okay for that? No question, quite easy, yes? Yeah. The goal is the goal was for us to not, because you can say also that one level of indirection could be enough. But for the goal was to say for the first level of indirection when we design the solution should be very, very small. The request should be very quick. So if you put a three, what we call the three prefix. Here you have very not a lot of entries, and then you go here. And this stage, I was talking, so you have the second level of indirection, and here we are storing the information about the object. You can say that it was possible to put it there, but we are storing here also all the metadata of the object, and many more information here. So the goal was to say, okay, this is the first level of indirection to do the directory, to go where we start to store data here, not actual data, but metadata and information about the bucket. And for the S3, we put also here some information about the credentials. So. Exactly. Yeah. The idea was really to keep that. Also, one important point here, let's say that I want to get the object 2, already stored as well. Let's say we want to get the object 2 in the bucket 1, still. Here with the YoProxy, we have a small cache that is caching the entries. So if you get right away, right after the object 1, the object 2, you will go directly to the Meta 2. Because the information of Meta 0 and Meta 1 are already in the cache. And you will go directly to the Meta 2. So usually the Meta 0 is filled in the cache quite quickly in big infrastructure. And for the most demanding bucket, the information is in the cache as well. So you go directly to the Meta 2 without doing every time these three hops to get to the data. Important thing here is that also with this three level of indirection, even if you have 1 gig of file with one bucket, you will do three hops to get to the data. If you have millions of buckets and billions of files, still it's three hops to get to the data. And most of the time, it's not three hops because the cache will lower this number. Okay? So we covered, let's say, 20% of the solution. Because there is one big thing I didn't mention here. It's okay with that, no question here. Is the famous conscience. So now let's say that I want to put a new object, new color. I want to put the object 3, and it's a new object. What will happen behind the scene with the conscience? The conscience is a service inside the technology, and you have on each node of the platform what we call the conscience agent. Conscience agent. And what is doing the conscience agent? The conscience agent is taking information for every services. Let's say that this is one node. It is taking information for every services like capacity, I/O, number of requests, many information, and giving back all this information to the conscience. With this information, the conscience has in its configuration the way the conscience has to calculate the quality score. I will explain you what is the score and the quality score for every services of the platform. So with this information, the conscience will compute a score and say, okay, this one, every score inside OpenIO is between 0, which is the lowest score, and 100, which is the best score. So every services of a platform with this asynchronous system that is done behind the scene will have a score. Let's say that this one will have a 60 score, this one 40, and this one 90. So we know, and the conscience and every services of a platform know the quality and the status of all the services of the platform. Now, why it's a good idea to do that, obviously? It's because if I want to put the object 3, so you will probably do meta 0, meta 1, but let's say that it's right away after reading this one, so you will go directly to one of the meta 2, let's say this one, and say, okay, I want to store a new object, the object 3, but it's a brand new object. So the meta 2 has the information here from the conscience that this, let's say that you have 5 rigs in your system, that this one is 60, 40, 50, 70, and 90. So the conscience, the meta 2 will answer to that, okay, if you want to store your data, again, we are in a 3-time replication mode, the 3 best rigs of the platform are this one, and this one. And so the meta 2 will tell to the proxy, okay, this is the best 3 place in the platform to store this data. So our Python API here will put the data on the 3 best rigs of the platform based on the information given by the meta 2. And then when it's done, when everything is acknowledged, the request will go again to your proxy and we will put the information in the meta 2 that there is a new object, the object 3. And here is the IP port where we store the data. Okay with that? No question? And then if you want to get the data, you have the information. And we'll store also the metadata as well here with the object, like the size, the MD5 sum, and information like that about the object, creation time, and so on. So the score is defined. The conscience agent is taking metrics, technical metrics for every services and every node of the platform. And you can put your own metrics. You can add new metrics. And then the conscience in the configuration, I can give you an example for the Oryx. By default, it's the amount of the capacity used in percentage. You multiply by the CPU left on the platform, multiplied by the I/O capacity, and then it's a cubic racine, a cubic root of that. The percentage of I/O available, percentage of capacity available, and percentage of CPU available. So between 0 and 100, you multiply these 3 and you do a cubic root of that. It's by default, but if you want to add, I don't know, the bandwidth available on the platform, you can add this metrics and put it in the scoring system. You can define your own scoring system. And so the conscience will choose the best disk to do that. What is very also Clever here, I'm seeing that for Florent, who worked a lot on this system, is if you add a new bucket, the scoring system is also done for the all the level of indirection here. So if you want to create a new bucket, let's say that you want to create the bucket 2 here, so it will be a totally different name, let's say 7, 5, C, 4, 2, and so on. So you will go here to the meta 1, meta 0, and meta 1, and say, OK, I want to create a new bucket with this name, and the meta 2, all the meta 2 in the cluster also have a score. So you will choose the best meta tool available to create your new bucket. Okay with that? It took me like months to understand that, so feel free to ask a question. And also what is really key, and this is one of our, how to say, best marketing point is to say when you scale your platform, you don't have to reshuffle and rebalance the data. Why? Because if you scale your platform, let's say that you add a new node, you will add a new meta 0, a new meta 1, a new meta 2, and a new RoX. And without doing anything, they will register to the conscience and will be available right away. And as they are not storing any data, they are not, they don't have any requests, they will for sure have a better score than the older one. So they will take a bit more load compared to the others. Not too much load, because if they have too much load, the score will go down. And they will tend to become homogeneous compared to the others naturally, without launching a rebalancing of data to the new services. That being said, you can, we have what we call movers to do that if you want to force it. But by default, you don't have to do that. And most of our customers are not doing it at all since many years. Why? Because also, if you put one new, let's say that we are in a three-time replication mode, if you put only one new RoX, they will put one of the copy here and two copy on the other node. And usually what happens is that as this new RoX will probably do more write than the others, the data will be right here and on other places, and we will read probably on the other places, usually, if the scoring system is well done. No question about that? I still have to introduce like 5 or 6 services, so if you have question now, it's time. Yes? So it's by services, and services are running on top of a disk. So usually in most of our deployment, here is the HDD, and here usually SSDs. That being said, it's not mandatory to put SSD here. For example, if you are doing a backup and archiving system, we have a lot of platforms without any SSDs. You mean about the score or about? No, the meta one knows the next level of indirection. Only the meta two involved in their prefix that they are managing. One important thing, just to be clear, it's you don't have any relationship like, okay, all the meta two, all the meta two served by this meta one are linked. It's not the case. I mean, meta one can work with all the meta two of all the platform. You don't have link. Okay, if you go to this meta one, for sure you will go to this meta two. No, every time you create a new bucket, there is a kind of, I know that Florent doesn't like when I said you have a kind of election of the best meta two. It's not an election because there is no quorum, but it's a kind of who is the best meta tool to store the data. So every time you create a new object or if you create a new bucket, you have the whole platform to store it and to create it. Any other question? Exactly. Yeah, exactly, exactly. It's at the end, it's open, so you can take the metrics you want and put it in a score as you want. And it could be like, okay, if there is no fault, it's one, so the score is not, it's the same. And if you detect one fault, you put zero and you put it in the score, so the service will go to zero directly. Yeah, exactly, exactly. Yeah. So you have usually we deploy one IO proxy per node, but you can use a remote IO proxy if you want. But usually you prefer to have, and the IO proxy is a stateless service, so you can put it ever. And the conscience usually we put two conscience per cluster with an HA proxy with a keep alive on top of it, because if you lose the conscience, it's not a spoof. Because if you lose the conscience, the only thing that will happen is all the services will take the last picture they have from the conscience. And the only thing you can see is that the choice will be less effective from time to time. So that's why we put another one. If this one is lost, all the services will register to the new one, and it will be. I'm saying that, but in the next release or. The conscience, they are working on doing a distributed conscience. So it will be done. Hey, George. No question here. Just to say it, if you want to remove an object, it's exactly the same process. And when you get the list of the Rx, you delete the data from the Rx, and then you delete the entry from the meta 2. And if you want to remove a bucket, then you remove the entry from the meta 1. Fine. What can I add here? If you lose one disk, let's say that, for example, you lose the services of or the disk where the services is working. We have also other services called reverse directory RDIR. And when you put a new object in the Rx, the reverse directory will be filled with this information. So if you lose this disk, you can ask to the reverse directory all the data that were stored here, and then we will rebuild the data on other nodes. It's just a way to faster the process of rebuilding a disk. If you lose also the reverse directory here, you still have all the information in the meta 2 to rebuild it if you want, but then you will have to crawl all the meta 2 to have this information. That's why we have designed this reverse directory to just faster the process of rebuilding a failed disk. In fact, this is not really how it works. We have a beanstalk DQ here. And every time you put a new object, it will put an event here. And then we have the OYO event agent here. I'm introducing because we'll need that for the grid for apps. You have an OYO event that will take this event and fill the RDIR. This is also the one who will fill our account system. And the account system is mostly used to do billing, for example, because you can ask to the account, OK, this specific bucket, bucket one, how many objects are stored, how much data are stored for this bucket. So you can, at the end, say, OK, this bucket is storing like 100 terabytes, and then you can bill them for this capacity. I guess I have covered all the services. Yep. So you have to format it. You put it or not again, you format it, and then you launch a rebuild by asking to the reverse directory, OK, give me all the objects stored here. And then you have multiple copies, so you'll take the copy somewhere else and rebuild it. You can rebuild it at the same place, Or you can say, okay, as to the constraints where I can rebuild it, and you take the process of choosing a new disk to do that. Also, everything here is every time we put here an object or create a new bucket here, we put also extended attributes on the object. So every time you find a file in the disk, you can know from which bucket the bucket this object is belonging to, from the object. So you can also rebuild the data. If you lose all the directory and all the meta0, meta1, meta2, you can rebuild your cluster starting only from the file, from the files you can find here. I covered everything. Good. Okay, we lost the... Any question about that? Okay, about the file system connector, it's almost not the same, but almost is you remove, it's not the S3 stack, but it's our OUFS stack. So you have, we have our OUFS, which is based on Fuse, with a Redis cluster here to have all the information about the file system. The inode table and so on. And then here is our C API, and at the end it's the same. So yeah, every time you put a new object in a folder is somehow a bucket, and then you store the data here. It's not based on the folder, it's made by, okay, every time you, here you have information about, okay, this object here in the cluster is belonging to this file in the file system. And in the Redis cluster, you have all information about, okay, it's in this directory and this file. And how it works behind the scenes is that it's a configuration, but by default, if I recall well, if you have more than 100,000 file in a bucket, then it creates a second one, and so on, every time you put new file in the file system. And then here you can, it's a file system, so here you can start your NFS, SMB, or whatever standard server. We didn't redevelop the NFS or SMB servers. It just start then on top of our file system. Okay? Yes, maybe it was a bit late to do this kind of presentation. So the next topic was about our serverless computing framework, which runs on servers. It's just, the good thing is here is that every time something is happening in the platform, we can create events here. So if you put a new object, if you remove an object, if you add a metadata, if you perform an operation, you can, it will create an object. By default, they are all trashed, but you can collect them. And what you can do here is to say, okay, if there is a new object, I can launch, you can take the event from the binsockd and launch a process. For example, if I take some example from our customers, it could be, okay, launch, we have everything on the on our blog, so okay, I can launch TensorFlow on the picture and say, okay, this is a car or whatever. And when you compute this data, then you can take action like, okay, add the metadata, saying that it's a car. And you can also build more complex workflow like, okay, this event, I launch it on TensorFlow. It's you put the metadata and then you put everything. Julien explained that, as explained that in other session. Put it in, for example, Elasticsearch cluster. So at the end, if you have billions of files here, you can say, okay, give me all the objects where I can find the car in it with this system. If I take other example, it could be, okay, for people who want to do hybrid cloud, every time a new object is stored here, I put one copy on a public cloud of your choice. So it allows you to have your cluster with all your data and one copy outside. If you don't have multiple data centers, but you want to replicate the data in multiple places, you can put your data, encrypt it, and put it away. what you can do. Yes, we had one use case with one of our partners. It was okay. It was they did that with a small Raspberry Pi on top of a camera, taking pictures. And they were doing a very short process here just to see if there is faces on the picture, and but very a small process. And if they found faces in it, they send the object to a bigger cluster with more CPU, for example, to recognize people in the picture. This is the kind of thing you can build with this kind of architecture. Okay, no question about the grid for apps. At the end, just I like to say that because it's coming from our marketing team. Only your brain is the limit here, because you take the event, you have a new object, and then you do whatever you want with that. Yep. Yeah. One other thing is could be, okay, I want to process a picture or video. It's CPU intensive, so I have a farm of GPU somewhere else. So I put the object on the GPU farm to process the data. It could be also to a trigger, to, I don't know, you have a very huge file to store, to say, okay, the file is well stored. This is also something that you can use to create your own event, to say, okay, for example, I don't know, you have a workflow where you have three copies of the data. Let's take the example of Dailymotion. I'm not saying that they are doing that, but this is the kind of thing we are discussing with them. Usually, with this kind of platform, with user-generated videos, they have the use case where you have a very interesting presentation like mine today, and probably 10 people will watch it, and probably all from my family. And you have a video with a cat falling in a box, and it will make billions of views. So they have this kind of workflow, and the idea was to say, okay, I have three replications of my data, but if this video is coming busy, then I put 10 replicates of my data, so I have more disk to get my data, and so you have better performance for this specific video because you have more people watching it. This is the kind of thing you can do. We will also use it in the coming months to perform operation inside OpenIO, like rebuilding system, like also changing a policy of an object, saying, for example, I don't know, if the object is older than 1 month, then I remove it from SSDs, because you can have ROX on SSDs for performance and ROX on HDD. And you can say, okay, after 1 month, we move the object from the SSDs to the HDDs. And for example, if for some reason the data is accessed again, you move it back to the SSDs. This is the kind of workflow you can build. What do you mean? You mean having one ROX able to do that? Yeah. The same ROX service. Yeah. This is something you can talk with Jean-François, our CTO, is looking at this kind of thing where you can have a disk with a bit of SSDs with it. So you write directly to the SSDs, so it's faster. Then you move it. Still, it's one service. Then you move it to the HDD. And for some reason, someone is getting it. You get from the HDD because it's an HDD. And then you move back to. So you have your kind of tiering directly in the ROX. Yes, of course, we can do that. We can talk also about what will come next, the roadmap, what you want. If you have any question about the services, or if I just to give you some stuff we are working on. One of the biggest things I asked the question myself is how does it work if I want to deploy OpenIO with Kubernetes or on Docker containers? Or it's a question I usually have. The biggest point here with Kubernetes is as all of our level of indirection are based on IP port, working on Kubernetes or Docker is not really efficient because we'll have to stick the Docker container on one node with the IP on still the same port, and the data has to be sticky. So it could be a good thing to use Kubernetes to deploy, but at the end, you don't take the good thing about Kubernetes. It's okay, I can start my my new services right away on another node. We already did that job for the Rix and the Meta 2. Now we'll have not an IP port, but an ID of services with a kind of DNS, So when will that will be done, we will be able, so we have still to work on it for the Meta 1 and Meta 2. This is available since the release of April. So it's done for the ROX and the Meta 2, and we have to do for the other level of injection. And then we will be able to deploy on Kubernetes and say, okay, if you lose a node, then the data can be, and the service can be started right away elsewhere. Just the data, the storage need to be available, but you will be able to start your services in a snap where you want. You want to change an Azure coding scheme or replication of an object. Yeah. So how it works. By default, you have what we call a storage policy for every, by default for the cluster. So every data will be stored, let's say, in full-time replication. You can override this information at the bucket level and say, OK, for everybody's full-time replication, but this specific bucket will take the five-time replication scheme or the RG coding scheme. And you can also override it at the object level. So you can have three-time replication for everybody, five-time replication for this bucket, and seven-time replication for this object in this bucket that is in the cluster. This is how it works. If you want to modify it and say, OK, it's three-time replication for everybody, and now I want to put the Azure coding, you can change it. All the new objects will take this new storage policy. And then if you want to modify the old one, you have to somehow rebuild it. You will say, OK, you are in a three-time replication mode, but the configuration is not this one. So you will somehow rebuild the data and put it in the new scheme. So you can change it whenever you want. And you in the conscience, you list, you can put as many as storage policy you want, and then pick it when you need to create a new bucket or store data. The same way. I mean, every new object will be in three-time replication. The old one will be still in five-time replication. And you will say, OK, I want to rebuild the data. It's not in the right configuration, so you will remove two copies of the data. And it's a process you have to run in the background. One thing also I didn't mention here, with the score for every services of the platform, you can put also tags. Your most common tags is the location. So you can say, OK, I want three ROIC services to store my data, the best three ROIC services of the platform, but I want them in three different data centers, rack, servers. And the tagging system, you can also put your own tags and put it in the way the conscience will choose the best services. For example, we have one customer who is taking other information, like I don't have the word in English, but in which electrical system the nodes is using. If you have, for example, one single rack, but some are in the in different power supply, you can say, okay, I want two copies, but in one in each. And the tagging system will also use to say, okay, I have SSDs, I have HDDs. So you can say also when you store a data, when you create a bucket, three copies for everybody, but this bucket will use only SSDs, and this other bucket will only use HDDs. So you can have also multiple configuration in the same cluster with some, let's say, gold bucket on SSDs and for backup archiving system in the same cluster using HDDs. Um, Any other question? One last thing, yes. We have also in our Swift and S3 gateway some features that you can enable, like because usually it's when you are storing, let's say that you are doing Erasure coding 6+3, so at the end you will have nine chunks of your data. If you store a 10 key file and you split it in nine chunks, it's a pain at the end, because if you store 1 billion of this kind of file, you'll have 9 billions of chunks, so it could be a pain. So we have features inside our S3 and Swift gateway, and you can say, okay, if the object is lower than, I don't know, 256 key, it's replication 3 times. If it's between 256 and 1 megabyte, it's erasure coding 4+2, and after that, it's erasure coding 9+3. So we can also, and from the user perspective, you don't have to choose anything. It will be done by the S3 gateway. It's okay, if the file is small, I will use some scheme, and if it's bigger, I will use other scheme. And we can also think about, okay, if it's, I don't know, PDF, it's on SSDs, and if it's a raw backup from your VMs, it's on HDD. Dynamically done by the gateway. You don't have to take care of that. We have our monitoring system that you can use to do that. Still, it's on you to check that your capacity. But it's a good question, because some people are not doing it at all, even if you have all the tools to do that. But the good question is, this is what we want to do next with the conscience. Today, the conscience is mostly something that is in a reaction from an event. And we want to do predictive thing with the conscience, changing the storage policy for a specific file with a specific load. But if you, let's say, dream a bit, it could be the conscience saying that we are full and adding new nodes, maybe on the public cloud, automatically. Or at least, let's say something more, just notify that you are full. If you want to try all these things, remember that you have our documentation website. If you want to deploy it, I don't know if some of you did the workshop. We use Ansible to deploy all the stack, so it's quite easy. Just to mention it, if you are interested by that, we have also all the Elasticsearch/Kibana for the log system. We use Prometheus and Grafana for the metrics. And we have also our WebZer interface to have like a map of your cluster on top of all these tools. And I think we are good. Thanks. And if you have any question, I'm still available almost all the night. We have also our community Slack. If you have any question, you can join slack.openio.io. And we are all there. And if you have any question, you can ask. We will do our best to reply as fast as possible.